when I say statistic, it's a portion, it's a big, big term. But we'll be focusing on activity session information limited to the, again, coming back to the bioavailability and bioequivalence studies. And I must thank Dr. Subbarani for making a platform for me to launch From There to Advance. It's already, basics are covered in her session. Dr. Prabhakar and Mr. Roy has already said about or said a lot about what statistics can be considered or used in our pharmaceutical industry. Yeah. We will be discussing these four topics in next 30 minutes. Advancement in bioequivalence studies. Again, I will not touch base clinical trials. Bioequivalence can also be discussed in the purview or in the scope of clinical trial. But here, we have a lot to discuss about BAVE. So we'll focus on BAVE and study designs, regulatory requirements. Because we know what is bioequivalence studies, but what actually regulator like DCGI, Indian regulator, ICMR for new chemical entity within India, US FDA, Europe, and many more are required or looking forward for any requirements. Very interesting complexity of study context. Study design, study protocol preparation, feasibilities are very easy to discuss. But when it comes into the conduct, there are insights, challenges. So that we'll discuss. And very important is challenges in outcome interpretation or interpretation of outcome results. Statistics will give you a lot, will tell you that what are the outcomes, but whether it is in line with what we have designed or whether it is in line with what actually statistical principles are, that is NR, and that we will cover over here. So with that note, we are taking first slide, wherein we have a different set of bioequivalence studies. We have discussed a lot on human BAVE phase 1 studies or generic comparison. That is in vivo study. So that would be covering crossover and replicate design, and Dr. Subbarani has already spoke a lot and discussed about statistics about these studies. But we will not go so much details because I understand there are, again, not correlating me with the statistic. It's a 60% around registrations are coming from the industry, maybe a non-statistician also. So we'll not go much about statistics to understand what is crossover or replicate, but we'll definitely look because it's an advancement in the bioequivalence study. Then PD endpoint based bioequivalence studies. We are talking about systemic absorption and all. So that is kinetics based, but there are several studies, there are several products, drugs, which may not be detectable or which the media would not be correct to go for kinetic study. So in that case, we will have pharmacodynamic studies. So PD endpoint study would be there. Then bioequivalence study with biological, different biological metrics. So that also will touch base. Very interesting, going to be in vitro bioequivalence studies, because earlier days we used to have a lot of human studies, then we went to simulation, then we went to in vitro data analysis. So based on even in vitro data, bioequivalence studies are acceptable to the agency. We'll touch those discussion also. Least but not the last, and this is probably the beginning of clinical research. In once again after 20 years is a biosimilars and biologics. So what biosimilars, what biologics, and what type of bioequivalence studies are required? I'll not going to explain what type of formulation challenges and what preclinical studies, but definitely what are the bioequivalence studies required for biosimilars or biologics, we would be touch based. So as we discussed already in previous session, why replicate design, why replications are required. Only one question. So anyone can say why replications are required? Because we understood that replicated studies are there. But why we need to go for those type of studies? Quick question, quick answer. Yes, please. Perfect.
Yeah, perfect. So there are only two options. You have to be within that goalpost, 81-25, what Madam said. But to be within that, you need lot of, when there is a high variability drug, variability is more than X percent is, we'll see, it's 30%. There you need so many sample size to prove, to shrink the confidence interval within the range, right? So this is the case when the variability is too high, high variability, it's not fitting within 81-25 criteria, and you want to be like this. So there are two options. One, either you increase the sample size to get more observation, or to administer same drug, or to replicate the drug, right? Test, reference, TR, RT, different sequences. It may be a partial replicate when you go for only reference replication. If it can be a fully replicate when you go for test and reference, both as a replication. So we talk about high variable drug, 30%, any drug having more than 30% are covered or considered as a high variable drug by the regulatory agency. Why? Because more than 30%, you would require exponentially high sample size. To reduce that, agency has allowed us to go for high variable drug approach. Why high variability occurs? Why not all drugs comes under low variable category? There are different physiological and different source of variations. Physiological factors like GI motility and gastric emptying, which may affect ADME of the drug. Inherent properties of the drug like first pass metabolism and all. Another things which can consider physicochemical properties of drug like solubility. So this type of parameters affecting a drug molecule, and because of that variability is observed within the same human volunteer. If you administer same batch, same product multiple times, you get the different profiles. So that's why it is considered as a high variable drug, and sometimes formulation effect also bring a lot or contribute a lot to the variation. A small touch base approach to high variability, and to control that, to ensure that, yes, I know that variability is going to be high, still I want to conduct a bioequivalence study, because without conducting bioequivalence studies, regulators are not going to allow generic products to come or to get the marketing approval. What are the options available for industry? Options like, yes, first of all, you have to have a replicate study design, wherein replication average out product difference, that's a benefit. Sometimes variability may not be too high. It is 31%, 34%. It's not too high. It's just marginally high. Another study, you may get 29% or 28%. What to do? Fine. Best option is not to take chance. Plan for fully replicate or partial replicate as applicable. At least it will help you to average out the data, and that may reduce the variability. More data, as we discussed, shrink the confidence intervals and bring the limits within the limits criteria. We are talking more about Europe and US FDA. Why? Because these are the basic regulations, and most of the countries are following these regulations. European region has allowed industry to consider wider limit approach to pass bioequivalence for the high variable drug. What would be the wider approach? Madam has already discussed a little bit. Next subsequent slide we'll see in detail. Similarly, US FDA, as we know, US FDA also have their different approach to conclude bioequivalence for high variable drug is RSABA, reference scale average bioequivalence approach. So European agency, as we discussed, yes, they believe in widening the limits. CIMAX, again, parameter allowed for widening is the CIMAX. AUCs has to be within 81-25 criteria, even though the product is highly variable. CIMAX, 90% variability, 90% confidence interval, limits up to 30%, 81-25, which is standard bioequivalence criteria. 30 to 50 is calculated based on simple expression given by the agency. Upper limit should be calculated based on sigma WR within reference variability is considered to consider to calculate lower limit as well as upper limit. And yes, they also have a put benchmark. Anything, any limit, any drug having variability more than 50%, the criteria is not going to be beyond this. This is the criteria, this is a limit. Any drug having ISCV more than or equal to 50%, lower limit has to pass 69.84, upper limit should be less than 143.19, right? It's not like that. If we have 75% variability, we can still go broader in the criteria. No, AUC has to be within 8125, and yes, T-bar ratio in any case has to be within 8125 for both the parameters. Moving little away, all the way different in terms of approach, US FDA scale average bioequivalence is provided by the FDA agency, wherein 95% confidence interval upper bound calculated based on this has to be less than 0. This is the first criteria, basic criteria, not difficult for any statistician working in the industry. But yes, it again contributes or calculated based on sigma WR within reference variability. Time point, the point estimate of T-bar ratio of geometric least square mean ratio has to be within 8125. So, purpose is that whatever approach you follow, it will be counted or accounted for sigma WR. So that's a benefit. Why? Otherwise, reference variability will kill the good formulation of test and would not allow them to come into the market. This is also a little bit discussed in the previous session. US FDA special bioequivalence approach for narrow therapeutic index drugs. Study should be fully replicated, there is no question at all, because we want variability within test as well as variability within reference. And yes, there are four criteria for that to prove: scale approach limits reference scale and compare test and reference product within subject variability. That's what sigma WT and sigma WR ratio should be less than 2.5. This type of criteria comes under applicable for NTI products like sodium warfarin and levothyroxine. And OGD, Office of Generic Drug, has clearly explained all detail and about scaling approach. As ma'am already shared, progesterone OGD has already described the SAS code also to bring in. So we'll not go much detailed in what we already have discussed about reference scale and all bioequivalence studies. So let's look what is PD endpoint. This is probably the point till this time no one has talked about. So PD endpoint bioequivalence study, when it requires. First of all, what is PD? How many of you know PD study? Just raise your hand. Okay, good. Oh, quite a good number of representations are there. So when it requires, we'll see what kind of PD endpoints are, right? PK based bioequivalence studies, I'm sure many of you coming from the industry have come across, or from pharma education, you must have seen that what is PK based. Even PD based also have covered in the academics. What are the regulatory requirements? That is also very important. I cannot come up with any PD endpoint and go for approval. There are some regulations. PD endpoint studies mainly require when PK or in vitro studies are not feasible. If something is feasible, if the drug is characterized appropriately within pharmacokinetic profile, systemic circulation, you don't need to go for PD. That's the first requirement. If something is possible based on in vitro study also, you can get a waiver of PD study. But if both gates are closed, then PD endpoint study are the way to go. PD could be pharmacological or therapeutic effect based endpoints. We'll see that as well. The very important is dose response relationship analysis. This is the base of PD endpoint, and what dose should be compared, what response is anticipated, that is what the PD endpoint analysis are. When we talk about PD endpoints, we are anyway going to see something in some metrics, right? So whatever methods, bioanalytical methods are going to be considered for PD endpoints has to be validated, particularly for specificity, sensitivity, accuracy, and precision of all. Why it is required? Because if methods are not precise, not validated, even though drug is affecting on certain parameters or certain metrics, certain samples, it won't come up as a PD effect identification. I put one pictorial diagram to understand dose response relationship. This is simple one, PK dose response. What is that? How many of you have understood this first picture? A is a linear dose PK relationship. Just raise your hand, and because I know few of you know this. So yes, Brijesh, first one, just explain quickly what it means.
We can say that if we gradually increase the dose, the PK will also increase for
right.
that dose relationship in the lab. We can say linear pharmacokinetics.
It's a linear, right? Thanks. So, say for example, PK. PK response like Cmax, maximum concentration, AUC, right? Whatever parameter you say, it has been considered for as a y-axis. And then when we change the dose, it may go up. And here, dose is different. Getting 0.51, 1.5, say for example milligram. So it is showing as dose increases, Cmax increases, AUC increases. This is perfect linear relationship. We are not talking that when we talk about PD impact, PD effect. PD effect will be most look like this. When dose increase, it may not reflect 100% into the effect size, right? So this is PD effect, wherein non-linear dose PD responses are presented. So both of these are PD effect studies, and this is PK relationship. For the interest of the group, have just listed some of the PD endpoints and some drugs which really requires PD endpoints as compared to PK, like Acarbose. Acarbose is a oral administered tablet required for indication type 2 diabetes. What it does, mechanism of action is it inhibits the pancreatic enzymes, and PD endpoint would be obviously it is a drug for controlling the diabetes. It has to be a glucose level measurement, and bioequivalence criteria to this type of study would be ratio of AUEC, area under the sound effect curve, right? And Cmax, everyone knows, has to be within 80-125. Similar like PK, Cmax and AUC 80-125. When it goes to Acarbose type of drug, when blood glucose, why blood glucose and we have considered AUEC? Does it difficult to take the blood samples? No, because that's what we do in bioequivalence studies. So instead of measuring the drug, we are checking the effect on the glucose lowering. So we always get proper ADME and all, not ADME, sorry, PK profile, concentration profile or glucose lowering, glucose profile at different time points, and we can calculate AUEC. Coming to the another product, which is known as Orlistat. What is that? It is a drug for indication obesity. It controls, inhibits the absorption of dietary fat. Whatever we eat, if we take this Orlistat, it will control fat inhibition. Endpoint is different. You can see there, it's a ratio of fecal fat excreted at steady state to daily ingested fat. So it goes on the fecal sample. We have to check the measure the amount of fat excreted. Jitna humne khane mein diya, right? Aur kitna recover kiya. I know it's going to be a very dirty study. We have conducted many study of this, but yeah, it's a challenging, and this is only the way this particular drug can proceed for regulation acceptance, because this drug is not detectable in the plasma concentration or whole blood concentration. So, and this is the activity. So, agency want US FDA, Europe, any agency, they want any applicant coming up with this particular product has to show bioequivalence of this measurement, 90% confidence interval of F within 8125. Everywhere you get 8125, and 8125 mystery was already discussed and explained by Dr. Rani. Some other molecule like enoxaparin and deltaparin, which is required for DVT, different indicators are there, NT10A, NT2A, these are the different PD endpoints. Again, effect of that also going to be, you can see that whatever we discuss, everywhere this 90% confidence interval, 8125, that criteria remains similar. And that is what the basis of what Schurman, Westlake, any researcher has done. This is different application of that criteria as an advanced bioequivalence study. Fluticasone propionate powder form, inhalation, anti-inflammatory effect, used for asthma or COPD. It may not be detectable in the plasma concentration. That's why area under the curve 0 to 12 hour of an FEV1, these are the parameters to be considered. Again, 90% confidence, same criteria required. So I just wanted to make the audience familiar that beyond PK, beyond plasma concentration, lot many things are ongoing in the industry. Okay, moving forward, what next? In our previous slide, we discussed about some different media other than plasma concentration. It may be a here it is going to be a plasma sample or whole blood sample. Here it is going to be a fecal samples, different samples. So what are the special biological metrics can be considered in a bioequivalence studies? So what are the special metrics when it requires for bioequivalence and any specific clarification by regulatory? Plasma. How many of you know that plasma is the most commonly used or considered matrix for bioequivalence? Just raise your hand. I know many of you are knowing, so I think it's going to be a question round two. Okay, plasma, most commonly used matrix for majority drugs bioequivalence study. Because of large availability of volume, sample, low risk of hemolysis clotting. Serum going to be another set of or another media similar like plasma, where the bioanalytical method is developed to detect the data in the serum, it would be whole blood. This is rarely considered because there is a high chance of clotting and hemolysis, but yes, certain drugs like tacrolimus or bortezomib need to be detected within whole blood, considering the high bounding of RBC. All these things, these are the commonly considered PK parameters for bioequivalence, Cmax, AUCs, Tmax, lambda z, etc. These two are primary and rest of these are secondary. Okay, I'm not going to turn to the next slide. I'm going to ask a question to you guys. This is a topic of various biological metrics. What can be the different biological metrics other than this? Correct. Correct. Aqueous humor, right. Saliva. Good. That's the next slide. Other urine, saliva, fecal samples, aqueous humor, I have not listed, but yes, that is there. Urine, why these type of samples are being collected? High excretion ratio, low detection in plasma, potassium chloride and iron sucrose type of drugs need to be measured on this metrics. Saliva mostly used for bioequivalence of anti-epileptic or narcotics product. Sometimes security department or things, they just want to check that the person is has consumed narcotics, then saliva tests are use. Fecal, as we discussed about oligostate in my previous slide, fecal samples are required to be considered for PD endpoint studies. Okay, unlike PK studies, what would be the parameters for this type of study? It cannot be a area under the curve of plasma or serum or like this. It's going to be a area under the effect curve because of PD. FFE24, this type of studies, bioavailability, then Emax modeling, area, amount of excretion, AUEC, AE. Coming to next set of studies where no human being, I'm not talking about the analyst or team doing the research, subjects, patients, they are no more involved in this type of studies are known as in vitro bioequivalence studies. Again, if I have to say in vitro bioequivalence studies, it's not exactly in vitro. During the method development or during the experimental design, they may use some human or plasma or something during the development. So sometimes it may correlate, but yes, what the studies we are going to discuss is pure in vitro studies. Criteria for bioequivalence obviously would be different than human studies. Illustration of couple of bioequivalence studies based on that. In vitro equilibrium binding studies. These are the studies you don't require to conduct a bioequivalence study. These are the product for which you don't require to conduct a bioequivalence studies, and based on this type of analysis, equilibrium binding experiments, kinetic binding, you can calculate different parameters, Lingvio test and all. T-bio ratio should be calculated for Ka parameter, and 90%, again, 90% sab jagah pe aayega, but here it is going to be 80-120. Why? Because it is not a human sample. This is in vitro. So this is equilibrium binding study, and similarly there is a kinetic binding study. It's a set of submission applicable for drugs like colsevelam, sevelamer, different. There are many nowadays, multiple studies are coming up with this type of requirements. So kinetic binding study, again it's a T by R bound phosphate ratio at various times should be compared for 90% CI, but criteria is not applicable. 80-125% criteria is only applicable in the equilibrium binding studies. Okay, so if someone would like to read more about that, there is a literature reference provided. Coming to very interesting point, which I personally like this topic, because a lot of bioequivalence generics we are discussing a lot. What of patient PK trials also we do, because the drugs which cannot be administered in a human, healthy human volunteers, we always have to conduct studies in a patient of the similar indication. But these are the biologics, biosimilars, what are they, we'll touch base. It's a fairly new concept. Not many submissions have been done so far to the agencies, so path is always clear, but it requires a lot of discussion, interaction, meetings with the regulators to understand their aspect, their requirement before conducting this type of studies. What is written? Almost an identical copy of an original product. Why I have to write almost? Why I have not written it's an identical copy or it's a second copy of the gen? Because that's a generic chemical. This is not the chemical. This may be a MAPS, monoclonal antibodies, derived from the proteins or that, not a chemical. It's a high molecular complexity, and based on that, even regulators are also very, very curious, suspicious, what I would say. They don't have much data to allow you on whatever you go and say. They always would like to discuss with you that, okay, what are your plans? What your molecule is, maybe we'll have some couple of example of different MABs or some biologics. Agency don't have many submissions. There are very few, fingertips counted, submissions have been done so far. So it's something like new products requiring or requesting for the permission. Again, since it is a new product category, it requires PK/PD and immunogenicity studies, because how the proteins may affect or immunogenicity can get deteriorated, antibodies can be developed in the healthy human volunteers or subjects that need to be presented to the agency. Sometimes, even though if you submit this type of data, agency would ask applicant or researcher or the company to conduct a clinical trial to prove that though it is a almost similar, you need, it is a new source of drug, you need to conduct a safety and efficacy. So this is what the biologics. So this is the next generation, then the chemical generic product. Within biologics, what type of PK endpoints? Similar to what we do for generics. PK remains PK. Cmax, Tmax, AUC is 90%, CI 81, 25%. But PD, there will be CD34, CD19, ANC counts, absolute neutrophil counts. Depending on the drug activity, you need to select this. And this selection has to be endorsed by the agency that whatever data you collect or generate, it's going to be acceptable to them. Immunogenicity, anti-drug antibodies or neutralizing antibodies. This is again, if you administer something to some human body, it may react differently. We do vaccination, right? That's a classical example of antibodies we inject to fight back against the disease. This is what, if this type of drug can generate or can create this type of antibody within the body, so that's what the concept is. So these three are the basic, and then special protocol review requires with the FDA or EU. As I said, agency have not clarified their aspect on many of the molecules. Yes, they have started, they have come up with some regulations, some instruction guidelines for particular set of products, but it's always advisable to go for protocol review or as you mentioned, kickoff meeting with different stakeholders, including regulators. Very critical from CMC, chemical data as well as quality data aspects. Few examples I have put over here is one, yes, I have added US FDA dates of approval for these biosimilars. This is one of the oldest approval given, or I would say first biologic was approved by US FDA on 6th March 2015. That was filgrastim. Indication is neutropenia. Subsequent all, etanercept, adalimumab, bevacizumab, trastuzumab and pegfilgrastim. This is the neonatal baby for US FDA. Recently approved for Sandoz in June 4th. So you can see that in 3 years, only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, maybe a couple of more products as a biologics are being approved. Simple studies, no. Lot of data is being generated, yes. Data integrity, data clarity, regeneration, reconstruction of the study is mandatory. All these submissions are 100% going to be scrutinized by the regulatory, unlike generic comparisons. They don't allow any applicant to just prove 8125 and through with the license. No. This is very critical for all biologics. So, till this slides, we have discussed different type of bioequivalence application like in vitro, biologics. I intentionally have not put patient PK trials over here because it may extend our presentation furthermore. But I would like to, since we have many people from non-statistical field also, what are the challenges being a statistician we face during industry while we work on different projects? So before we talk about challenges, let's talk about some complexity also, feasibility. Any statistician coming, or I would not say only statistician, M-Pharm, pharmacokinetics, pharmacology, these people are highly or directly involved in this feasibility inputs process. What is this feasibility input process? Nothing is ready to eat in this industry. You need to plan your study based on your experience, history of data, literatures, whatever. Someone was asking about if we don't have data to plan the study, what should be done? Yes, there are a way. As Madam said, we can go for different type of study designs, adaptive, group sequential and all. Or even we can use literatures and that to get the feasibility of the data, feasibility of the study. It's not only stats. It's a pharmacology, right? Understanding the ADME of this product, even safety, right? So safety of the drug is also essential. And then challenges at conduct stage, we'll take it little fast. Understanding the molecule, ADME, then have access to the PKPD profile based on the previous experience. Optimization of the sample size, I'll not talk a lot because previous lecture has already covered this. Protocol inputs and standardization of the process. Why this is critical? Sab kuch ho jane ke baad pata chalta hai ki yaar ye protocol mein hota to acha hota. So right input at protocol level is very essential, even bias statistician. Conduct stage, availability of subject, dropout, discontinuation, non-compliance of the subjects. Many times you design everything picture perfect, but you don't get anticipated data because of sometimes non-compliance of subjects or some unidentifiable cause. Lot of investigation we do from PK aspect, but it's all post hoc. Minimization of deviation is very good to get the desired data, and yes, to be with ethics, GCP and GLP is mandatory. Data interpretation challenges are simple thing. Whatever you plan, plan perfect, plan adequately to avoid any list of change or amendments later on. So protocol inputs and SAP is an art, so it always need to be come up as an experience. Understanding the statistical tools, applicable statistical tools and analysis is also required to be known by any statistician in the industry, and accurate presentation of the results, accurate, it should not be misinterpreted. Inference, that's why I have written, statistical inference is an art, and that's why SAR and CSR need to be properly written, validated, QC'd, QA'd, everything has to be done before it goes to the agency. Last slide about regulatory bodies, how to avoid regulatory queries. You follow regulation, regulatory will not stop your applications or approvals, but sometimes while following the regulation also you get lot of challenges which we discussed in the previous slide, and that's why these regulatory queries would come into the picture. It has to be answered properly, adequately, with all possible justification. No extra, sometimes yes, you may require to do some extra experiments to support your answer to the agency, and it has to be politely presented to the agency. It should not be offensive, and that this is very important. Keep updated with the latest regulation. To avoid regulatory queries, yes, you should know what the regulator is going to accept. If you follow that, yes. And this pharma industry, clinical research industry, regulatory is every day you get something new, new study design, new challenges, new drugs. Someone might have done some study differently, regulatory would like to go with that approach, so they want a follower to make their application in that way. So we'll not stretch further, it's already alarm for me.